Hello, my name is David Craker. I am a data dissemination specialist at the U.S. Census Bureau, and today I'm going to be guiding you through the class, the ins and outs and whereabouts of census geography, and more specifically, we will be looking at administrative geography, and that covers congressional districts, school districts, state legislative districts, and voting districts. And just like in all the other modules, today I will give you a little lanyap. That means something extra, a little bonus in this. I will also take you one time out into the field, and another time I will actually work through one of our products online so that you can see how that works.
So what is administrative geography? We have this definition. Administrative measures create administrative boundaries, specify their governmental or administrative functions, and contain provisions for establishing and changing their names and boundaries. We also have another definition. Administrative geographies are legal geographies whose areas may fluctuate depending on their population. And so we do have another module that talks about legal geographies, but we have chosen to pull these four geographies out of that. And we call them administrative geographies because their boundaries may indeed fluctuate over time because of their population. This is our hierarchy, geographic hierarchy, and we like to show people how different things nest within other things at the Census Bureau, or how we perceive it. And these are the four concepts that we will explore today. We will look at congressional districts, which nest within the state. Over on the right, we will look at state legislative districts, which also nest within the state. Below that and on the left, we will look at voting districts, which nest within counties. And then just above that, at the very end, we will take a quick look at school districts, which actually nest within the state. So congressional districts. Congressional districts are established by law for the election of representation to the United States Congress. Each congressional district is to be as equal in population to all other congressional districts in the state as practicable, based on, you guessed it, the decennial census. The number of congressional districts in each state may change after each decennial census, and the boundaries may be changed more than once during a decade. In the District of Columbia and Puerto Rico, a single congressional district is created consisting of the entire area. The representative is termed a delegate or a resident commissioner, respectively, and does not have voting rights in Congress. And so also many people ask us about apportionment, and that is the process of allocating a number of representatives to different states. Apportionment changes are often accompanied by redistricting, and that is the redrawing of electoral district boundaries to accommodate the new number of representatives. And so let's go to the next. So here I have a little lanyap for you, and the idea is that, did you know that congressional districts are apportioned? Of course we do. We just talked about that, right? But every 10 years after a decennial census, depending on the population numbers, congressional districts may be redrawn. And so I urge you to watch this video on YouTube. It is called The Amazing Apportionment Machine, and it will explain to you in a nutshell how apportionment is carried out. State legislative districts. They are areas from which members are elected to state legislatures. The state legislative districts, sometimes in-house we call them SLDs, embody the upper, meaning the Senate, and the lower, the House, chambers of the state legislature. And these districts are delineated by each state at varying times using their own methods, usually after a 10-year census. The state governments will use updated census population counts to determine how to portion their own districts. Voting districts are any of a variety of areas such as election districts, precincts, legislative districts, or wards established by states and local governments for voting purposes. They are created to provide population with representation in the larger state's legislative body. Generally, only voters or constituents who reside within the district are permitted to vote in an election held there. States participating in the Census Redistricting Data Program provide the Census Bureau with boundaries, codes, and names for their VTDs, voting districts. That's what we, in-house, we say VTD. Voting districts not defined, which I have here, are names assigned to an area within a county for which no voting district information is known by the Census Bureau. This designation is used if the state government chose not to provide the Census Bureau with voting district boundaries, or if that portion of the county is truly devoid of voting districts. For example, some coastal or water areas are like that. And so follow me out into the field with this next video as I try to show you a little bit about a voting district.
So today is voting day in my own town, and this is a polling place which is in a local voting district. The Census Bureau, we do draw voting districts, and we allow people to use those to see data about different areas. We do need to remember that voting districts are dependent on population, and they may fluctuate from time to time. They fluctuate because of population, and also because there needs to be a polling place where people can go in to cast their vote. So what we are going to do now is take a little walk from this polling place, right, to another polling place, which is just a few blocks away. And the important thing for you to notice is that there is no change. You see no differentiation, nothing changes, the roads don't change, nothing changes, but it is another local voting district, and I just want to show you how close they are to each other. So just bear with me.
This is my state, New Jersey, and my town, South Orange, in the north of New Jersey. We are going to walk from the voting district 2 polling place to the voting district 1 polling place. You won't be able to tell when we've passed from one district into the other.
So here is our second polling place, just a few blocks from the first one, not very far at all, but certainly it is here that the municipal district is drawn because of population and also the need to find a place for the polling place.
A school district is a geographic entity within which state, county, or local officials provide public educational services for the area's residents. The boundaries and names are provided by state officials. It's done annually. The structure of the school district geography varies by state and region, and the districts that share the name of a county, city, or town, or operate schools for these areas may or may not be coterminous with a governmental unit. Districts in the Mid-Atlantic and New England states tend to follow county, township, or city boundaries, while districts in the Midwest, Great Plains, and Western states are generally independent of other municipal boundaries. And there are three types of school districts. We have elementary, secondary, and unified. So, an elementary school district provides elementary school districts provide education to the lower grade or age levels, and the secondary school districts provide education to the upper grade and age levels. Unified school districts provide education to children of all school ages in their service areas. So, in general, where there is a unified school district, no elementary or secondary school district exists, and where there is an elementary school district, the secondary school district may or may not exist. Let's take a quiz. Which of these is not an example of administrative geography? So more than one answer is possible. State legislative district, metropolitan statistical area, congressional district, or census designated place. So once again, which of these is not an example of administrative geography? And that answer is metropolitan statistical area and census designated place. Both of these are statistical geographies, and I do explain those concepts in the module called statistical geography. So our second question and last question, which one of these does not use decennial census data to help inform how to redraw boundaries? State legislative districts, local voting districts, congressional districts, or county boundaries? The answer is county boundaries. That is a legal boundary, and it is not dependent on population data or that to say decennial census, and is consistently there.